God is so good that we can come here together and give God praise, glory, honor. We just want to call on the name of the Lord. And we start that by lighting this candle, which represents hope tonight, hope and unity in the name of Jesus Christ. I'm hoping that you will see the light. I'm praying that you will feel the experience of God's light as we prepare ourselves to worship. Our worship leader tonight is Michelle Mears. So let's be about the business of, before we do our worship leading, let us see our announcements and see what's happening in community. Amen.
Welcome to New Hope Presbyterian Church, where you matter. Whether you are a first-time friend or part of our church family, we're glad you're here. Before our service begins, we have a few things to share with you. Please listen carefully to the following announcements. Join us for prayer Thursdays at 6 p.m. Let's stand together in the power, promise, purpose, and potential of all that prayer can do. Mark your calendars and spread the word. Jazzy Christmas will be on Sunday, December 15th at the Kennedy Performing Arts Center in La Palma. Share with your family, friends, and neighbors. This show will be spectacular. Join us on World Mission Day for the premiere of No Longer Forgotten, a documentary that beautifully captures the journeys of the Goodjoin and Jurgensen families in Kenya. This screening is scheduled for October 19th at 6 p.m. in the Oliver Center. The White Coat Ceremony for Dr. Mee will take place on Sunday, September 22nd. There is still time to register children, grades K through 5. Check the newsletter for more information. The New Hope Orange County Orchestra will have its community debut on Saturday, October 5th at 6:30 p.m., following the Saturday service. Come support these talented musicians and learn more about how to get involved. 2 Corinthians 9:7 tells us that God loves a cheerful giver. Every gift, no matter the size, makes a significant impact. Thank you for your generosity and for helping to keep our church and its mission vibrant and strong. Today's scripture is Isaiah 50, 4-9a. We must stand strong in trusting God together. Bless someone today by texting or calling to let them know that they matter. Have a blessed and wonderful worship service today.
Good evening, church.
Good evening,
Michelle.
You know, as Pastor invited you to come forward, I was reminded of the years that I spent in the classroom teaching, so you all get A's. I hope we can keep it real this morning, or this evening, I should say. Keep it real in the sense of what we have experienced, whether it's this week, or even reflecting upon life in general. How many of you have experienced weariness, feeling weary? Yes. I'm going to invite you to rise, if you're able, for the call to worship. And bear in mind what the Lord has to say about weariness. Come. All who are weary, for the Lord God has given us words of life to sustain and strengthen us.
Morning by morning, God awakens us, opening our ears to hear and our hearts to receive.
The Lord God is our help, and we shall not be disgraced.
We will set our faces like flint, trusting in God's presence, for the one who vindicates is near.
Let us stand together, be together, in faith, for God is with us. All together?
We come to worship the God who teaches, sustains, and defends us.
Thank you.
I read something this morning that I want to share with you before we go into the prayer of confession and hope. Lisa Marie Lovett has an Instagram post called Season Dialogue. And she shared something that I will not share in its totality. I will just share excerpts of it. I met God on the floor in my living room. I met God when my knees hit the ground. God's voice came like a whisper to push me forward, to nudge me into spaces that I long resisted. He met me in the cracks of my own spirit. It was in those intimate moments when the noise of the world faded away and my heart opened just enough to let him in. I met God in the moment that I let him in.
Amen.
Please hear the prayer of confession. Merciful God, we come before you with hearts that tremble, burdened with fears and uncertainties that cloud our faith. We confess that in our moments of weakness, we've allowed fear to overshadow your promises, forgetting that you are the God who comes to save. Open our eyes, Lord, that we may see your hand at work in our lives. Unstop our ears that we may hear your voice of comfort and direction. Strengthen our weakness, our weak knees, and give us the courage to leap with joy in your presence. Loosen our tongues that we might sing of your goodness and proclaim your mighty works. Thank you, Lord, for your unfailing love and the salvation you bring. In your holy name, we pray and seek your grace and mercy. Amen.
Thank you.
could just
This is my first day on the job. But praise be to God to be a member of this community where you matter.
Amen. And you matter.
Hear the words of assurance. Hear the good news. The Lord our God is faithful and full of compassion. God has promised to come and save us. And God's word is true. Even in our fear and uncertainty, God's love remains steadfast. God opens the eyes of the blind, unstops the ears of the deaf, strengthens the weak, and brings life to those barren places. Because of God's great mercy, we are forgiven and restored. Be strong. Be strong. And do not fear, for God has come to save us. Rejoice and be at peace, for in Christ we are made whole. Thanks be to God.
Thanks be Amen. To God. Amen. You're welcome.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I met God in the moment that I let him in. Thank you, Michelle. Now is the time for prayers of the people, and this is one such potential moment. We all could have stayed home and met with God on the floor of our living rooms, but it's just a little bit easier with all of us gathered here today when we're beautifully led, and we can feel the presence a little easier standing next to each other. And this is the opportunity where we get to vocalize what we might call the secret burdens. The places of sorrow, of improbable hope, of fear. And so if you can, please rise and join me. And I will just say that among other things, such as asking God to intervene, one of these ways in which this is a moment for us to meet God is to speak something out loud and to have the experience of have it being witnessed by God and by each other. And so if you will just take this moment to quiet your heart, to allow those secret places to unfold just slightly, that we might meet with God and have the comfort of knowing that the Trinity was already there, fearing and hoping and longing with you. Please go ahead and call out the names of those people and places in your life that you would like God to hear and for us to stand with you in.
Rashawn.
Chris. Anthony.
Shelby, Carolyn, and Paul, Kim, Nyla, Emmanuel, Ron, Susan, Alexis, Eugene.
God, we thank you that you invited us here because you wanted to hear things you already knew, but things you wanted us to have the experience of having you listen to. I pray for all of us here that we would have the experience of a burden being lifted, as we know that it is one that you share and that you care for deeply. Please intervene on behalf of those that we have lifted up and those that we have not. We put our trust in you, and we are grateful for your presence and response and grace. Amen.
Amen.
Let the church say amen.
Amen.
We got some spirit in this place. All right. Well, now we come to God's word. And I'm sure, as everyone else should be sure, that God has a word for us. Amen?
Amen.
Right. Coming from Isaiah 50, verses 4 through 9. I'm going to say a little, but not too much, because I'm here to read the word, not preach the word. A key insight from Isaiah, and Isaiah, when we look at the book as a whole, is about prophesying what we call the suffering servant. And so that covers several chapters in the Old Testament, especially in that book and some of the other books, prophetic writings. So a key insight from Isaiah's text includes more than prophesying about this suffering servant, because he's preparing us, the one who is to come on behalf of God and who will suffer on behalf of God's chosen, that they may be saved from their sins. Rather, the insight from this passage we are about to hear requires us to learn the difference between pain and suffering. Pain and suffering. Number one, pain and suffering are not identical. They're not the same. Suffering is not a bodily sensation. Rather, it is spiritual. Y'all with me?
Yes.
Number three, and finally, suffering can be a reaction to pain, but not necessarily pain. Listen carefully to the prophet Isaiah as we think on these things, and as our pastor unlocks further the wisdom that is embedded in this passage, Isaiah 50, verses 4 through 9a. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. Morning by morning, he wakens my ear to listen as those who are taught. The Lord God has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I did not turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me, and my cheeks to those who pulled out the beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. The Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have been disgraced. Therefore, I have set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near, who will contend with me. Let me stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. It is the Lord God who helps me. It is the Lord God who helps me. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
All my help, all is wrong.
are witnesses to the help and the love of Jesus Christ. God has brought us into this space where we will grow in God's truth and we will be about God's business. Indeed, it is true that there is a difference between pain and suffering. And all that we have suffered, I can truly tell you there is comfort. And the reality is that God has allowed us to move into a victory while we've suffered together. Yes. While we found retreat and believed in promise. Yes, pain can be a remnant. Pain can certainly be an emotional attachment to the suffering. But if I could just tell you personally, all that I've suffered, I know through this church, I haven't suffered alone. And all that we have faced in the atrocities of life, God has given us a space in which we can reflect upon and live into the salvation of Jesus Christ together. It indeed is a collective hope. Look at how God blesses. Yes. Yes. Big ways and small ways, and I take none of it for granted. God bless because, you know, I grabbed Reggie's glasses and they were the wrong prescription. And he knew it. I couldn't read a thing. That is why you have me out here extemporaneously speaking to you. Because I knew God was going to show up. Amen. We must stand together. There really is no turning back. And we must stand together in the midst of the trials that we are facing. This truly relates to what Brother Don was saying, what he shared in the scripture of prophecy, prophetic hope coming from a suffering servant. You see, in a world that often praises individualism and self-reliance, this scripture helps us to make room for cooperation and collaboration. It reminds us of a deeper strength, that our help does come from the Lord. All of our strength comes from God, and God has shown repeatedly that strength comes from standing together with others in faith. I can give you some examples. I think about the early church, Acts 2, 44-47. In the early days, believers came together, sharing their possessions, supporting one another. They prayed together. They broke bread together. They lived in unity together, Minister Sheila. This collective strength and mutual support were instrumental in spreading the gospel and the growth of the church. Their communal life exemplified how standing together in faith can lead to a profound spiritual practice and profound spiritual outcomes that make us see how suffering is a spiritual thing. I think about Paul and Silas. Paul and Silas in Acts 16, they were together in prison, and what they did together in that suffering, in that spiritual turmoil, was they sang hymns together. They praised God together. Even in the dire circumstances, their unity and faith was comforted by the presence of God and their collective gathering in, to the point where the jailer converted. And so did his family. But the one that really stands out to me that I wanted to share with you tonight, in this example of standing together in the midst of spiritual warfare, and spiritual warfare is a part of what suffering is all about, is Moses and Aaron in Exodus. So how do I sum this up? There was a battle going on. And Moses and Aaron and Hur were demonstrating the power of standing together. And as long as Moses held his hands up, the Amalekites were not winning. And so he would hold his hands up. But when his hands started to grow weary and his arms started to cave in, Moses and Hur would stand and lift them up and hold them up for him. They did that for 12 hours. Believing in the power of togetherness and the strength of God to provide. And this story highlights how collective support and collective teamwork and collective hope allows us to get through the suffering times, the tangles and the mangles of life. Isaiah 54 through 9 offers us a picture of this servant who stands firm and facing in the face of suffering. And you're right, it didn't say anything about in the face of pain. It was in the face of deep suffering. This servant was emboldened by God's help and the support of the faithful. This passage shows us how we can endure hardship, not in isolation, but in unity, confident that God is with us every step along the way. What we're called to do is stand together, support one another, rooted in faith and empowered by the knowledge that God vindicates those who remain steadfast. So some of you know, and if you haven't gotten a call from me yet, you're going to get a call, you're going to get an email, you're going to get a personal appeal to come to prayer. I don't call you for my own health. Not at all. Don't come for me. Come to prayer because God, through me, told me to call you. You can come or not come, but just understand, it's not a favor to me. It's not sentimental. It's the power and the relevancy of knowing that God is stirring something up in this church. And if God tells me to call each and every one of you, I'll keep calling until God says you don't have to do it anymore. So I hope that you will not feel nagged or dragged or as if it is insulting to be invited to prayer. But we are a suffering community.
Yes.
We are suffering individuals who need to stand strong in the power of collaborative and corporate prayer that may start at this light and spark a light in your bedroom where you meet God on the floor, on your knees, where God is waiting, and let it be what it is. But it is all about, let me just say it this way. The call to stand together from Isaiah 58 is not a soft, it's not a sentimental, romanticized idea about unity. It's not about simply feeling good or being friendly or offering some kind of vague encouragement. Instead, it's a call rooted in the harsh reality of human suffering, injustice, trials. It's a call to true solidarity, standing together with others in the most difficult of circumstances where real sacrifice and real compassion and real action are required. Standing together against racial discrimination. Is standing together against the idea that a woman doesn't have a right to do what she wants to do with her body. Is standing together so that Haitians do not have to be ostracized and criticized and treated as though they are barbaric. We have to be the ones to break the cords of suffering, and we cannot do it alone. We must do it together, drawn into a space where God will do a work. And what God requires is that we would find a way through our prayers and through our worship and through our relationships and through our depth of spiritual understanding and even through our ignorance to overcome the wave of easy insults, character depictions that put marginalized people in places where they are distrusted all the more. We are called to a unity, to stand together, to take back decency and dignity against destructive name calling and browbeating that has become a sadistic form of entertainment in this country. When the prophet says in verse 8, let us stand up together, the prophet, the servant, is pointing to the deep need for humanity to unite, especially when facing adversity. It's a call to rise as one. It's a call to rise as one in the trenches of life through the injustices and oppression and human struggle. This kind of unity is never comfortable. It's never easy, but it goes down a little easier when you've got me and I've got you and we've got each other. Oh, it's challenging and demanding. It requires us to set aside differences and self-interests so that we care deeply for one another. I'm gonna call out Bertha Andrews. Is she in here right now? There she is right there. I'm gonna call you out. Reggie said, call her. I know she gets this because she said, you know, and I'm paraphrasing, our hospitality has to be more than a meal over there. We have to touch each other's lives over there. I want this ministry to grow in such a way that when you leave worship and go into fellowship, you know that you're united with a group of people in a more powerfully, spiritually strong sense. Because it is the antidote to the suffering that we face that we sometimes feel that we cannot change. It is the essence of what hospitality is really supposed to be about. I'm with you, you're with me, we're together with God, celebrating victories like passing tests, which you just told me about. Amen. She just passed all of her tests. Give me just. If I had to suffer this church by myself, y'all wouldn't know me. I'd be gone. I'd be gone. But because we choose to be a family in Christ, and because I can call you Brother Don at any given time, because Antoinette, you can call me at any given time, because Margot, you can call any one of us at any given time, because we have each other, and we're simply a microcosm of what the community is supposed to be about, we can put a big dent in the pains, yes, the pains, and the depth of suffering that we find ourselves in this spiritual battle called life. Nobody wants to suffer. I'm not suggesting that. Who wants to suffer? I will never pray that you will wake up tomorrow and suffer so that you can feel a victory later on. That's ridiculous. But listen to Isaiah. I'm going to break down all these verses. And no, you won't be here another 45 minutes. It's just going to take me a minute, though, to break down these verses. No, ma'am, not right now. We must sustain the weary in God's word. Isaiah 54. The Lord God has given me the tongue of a teacher that I may know how to sustain the weary with the word. Morning by morning, he wakens my ear to listen to those who are taught. You see, the servant Isaiah speaks of being taught by God. equipped with words that can sustain the weary. This is a powerful reminder of the importance of community. And just as God gives the servant words of comfort, we too are called to speak words of hope to one another, especially in times of trial. In a world filled with burdens, we need voices of encouragement, like what Ben gave us today. Those who will remind us of God's love and God's promise and see us through. Yes, in our journey, we are going to encounter weariness, both in ourselves, in others, and in the world. It is a spiritual fight. But when we stand together in that spiritual fight, studying the word, being taught the word, walking in the word, praying together, we strengthen one another. We listen for God's instruction, and we offer that comfort and hope to those who need it. And that is what hospitality. That is the hospitality of a prophetic woman who is trying to get us there. Standing firm in obedience together, Isaiah 55 through 6. Let's just have some lessons here. The Lord has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious. I didn't turn backward. I gave my back to those who struck me and my cheeks to those who pulled out my beard. I did not hide my face from insult and spitting. If that doesn't take us to the cross, I don't know what will. Here we see the servant willingly embracing suffering for the sake of mission. He doesn't rebel. He doesn't turn away, even when faced with opposition. This image reflects the kind of faith and obedience that we are called to have. That there will be times when standing for what is right will come at a cost. But we must remain faithful, trusting that God sees our struggles. Oh, and then you know the choir just sang this. You know, Reggie and I don't always get to talk about what song is going to go with this message, and it just always seems to work out. Isaiah 57 through 9, God as our helper. The Lord helps me, and therefore I have not been disgraced. Therefore I set my face like flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. He who vindicates me is near. Who will contend with me? Let us stand up together. Who are my adversaries? Let them confront me. Come on, do what you think you can do. Because I know who I have. The servant's confidence is grounded in the knowledge that God is his helper and God is his vindicator, and all of his help is going to come from the Lord. He knows that despite the suffering, despite the insults he endures, he will not be put to shame because God is near. This is the source of an unshakable resolve. I've set my face like flint, and we don't need to fear the opposition that would seek to destroy. Because God is our advocate, God is our vindicator, and we stand together as a community. This servant's invitation to stand up together is truly a call to solidarity. In the face of opposition, we're not called to fight our battles in isolation. God has designed the church to be a body, a family, where we uphold one another, where no one stands alone. I can't tell you how many names in this church just pop in my head when I think about what it means to walk the mission together. Oh, but when we come together, y'all, nothing can stand against us. I've seen it over and over again. We are more than conquerors through him who loves us. Let the world see us rise up in unity. Let the community in the heavens witness our strength. Let every challenge know that we are not moved from the fundamental truths of justice and freedom. We stand together. We fight together. We are victorious together. Our God is with us together, and in his name we shall prevail. It makes me think of the song that used to be sung in the 1960s during the civil rights movement. I think I know it even more. I shall not be moved. It's a powerful hymn rooted in African-American tradition, often sung in the context of struggle, often sung in the context of suffering and perseverance and courage. God is in that song. Jesus is in that song. It became so popular in the social justice movement that as I was preparing this message, I couldn't help but to sing it over and over again. It's our hope. It's our faith. It's not our all in all. It's what God gave us. Margot could put the song up, maybe. I don't know. It doesn't matter. And we could see who wrote that song. But God gave us that song. And then I thought, I bet they say, Chanel's always going back to the 40s and the 50s. Doesn't she know something from the 70s and the 80s? The 90s. Someday when the glory comes, it will be ours. Yes. It will be ours. Yes. There's glory. There's glory that's coming. And it's coming to us as a community that is just tipping the iceberg of what it means to know that there's victory and suffering together. Yes. All right. But see, I don't know glory all the way through. Alva does. But I know this, I shall not be moved. I shall not be moved, just like a tree that's planted by the water. I shall not be moved. Whatever we suffer, if we suffer it together, we will get through it together. We will walk in the peace of Christ together. No divorce, no national disaster, no political strife will stop the movement of God to say, I will not turn back. We cannot turn back. We would not have this church if we hadn't suffered together. Melody, I walk hand in hand with you all the time because we know what it means to suffer together and to fight the good fight for Jesus Christ. Now, I said Melody's name. I could have said any one of y'all's up in here. Because we know, and we've been given a suffering servant who has reminded us that together we can get through anything. It's our act and declaration of the greatest hope of all. I shall not. God is so good. When they tried to take this church, maybe some wouldn't consider that suffering. It was hard, but together we got through. Yes. When they said we were nobody, God said you're somebody. Yes. And we suffered that blame together. Yes. And we've come into a space of love, hope, and peace that we are required to take out into the world. Sometimes it's painful. But the suffering of it results in victory. And we stand victorious right now. And that victory is also when, honestly, I don't know how this, maybe this isn't the best segue, but it is my truth. It's my truth. It really is. That victory is in how we give back to this church, even financially. Amen. The church should not suffer. The church will not suffer because we make a commitment to share in the love of God by the way in which we use our monies to build the kingdom. And we invite you to prepare for that right now. You can come on forward. Marionette, you can come on forward. Offering is an act of worship. Offering is an act of solidarity. Offering is an act of collective giving. Let us pray together. We shall not be moved, dear Lord. We continue to grow in your truth and your grace, and we thank you that you keep taking our roots deeper and guiding us into a greater faith and hope. May it be manifested in our giving tonight, this collective hope, the solidarity of impact against suffering in the world. Use our giving to build community, Lord, because it is what we are about. Bless this offering in Christ's name. Amen. And ever, any first-time friends with us today who would like to just say hello, we welcome you at this time. Any first-time friends? We're glad to have you here today. We pray that you have felt the love of Christ and that you will join us again. God bless you. Amen. And if we have any among us who have decided, yep, today's that day, I want to join this church. I don't need to wait any longer. All you have to do is raise your hand. We'll be here for you. Did you just raise your hand? Oh, I'm sorry. She was adjusting her glasses. God is good. God is good. Yes, he is all the time. May the grace, peace, and love of our Jesus, Lord and Savior Jesus Christ be with us as we commit to standing together, as we commit to sharing God's love in the world, as we commit to being more hospitable than we can imagine. Go out in solidarity and peace. I love you. We love you. God bless you. Amen.